olvídate de nosotros, olvídate de Cuba.
Una vida normal, una familia, un hogar.
El arte, tu hogar, coño.
Debo ser el único cubano que quiere estar en Cuba.
Tú eres negro y esta es la oportunidad de tu vida. Yo te puse el nombre de un lindo bravo el día que naciste. Tú eres Yuli y vas a ser el mejor bailarín del mundo.
So, first question is to Paul. We know that Andrea Calder had sort of suggested that take a look at Carlos's biography, and it was your first bar pick you took on. But what about the story persuaded you to take this on and write the screenplay?
Oh, there were several things. Well, first of all, it was Carlos himself, because, you know, it's a, you know, you're committing 2 years of your life to a project, and so you have to feel you're going to get on. You know, it's one thing to meet in a wee cafe around the corner, but then it's to spend 2 years working. But you have to follow your instinct. And from immediately, Carlos was very open. He was smart, he was modest, and so we just took, it was a leap of faith, really. And Thea and myself, we wanted to work together in a project. Thea spent a lot of time in Cuba. So we said, well, we don't know if we'll find a way into this, but let's go to Cuba, let's go to Havana. And we watched him rehearse with his young dancers. He's got a dance company out there, and they were just very, very special. I mean, they're really remarkable. They're Champions League kind of dancers, you know, and we just thought, really, it would be a great thing if we danced on with his life, and that would be original. It would be a huge challenge, and perhaps we could also get Carlos to be involved in that.
And what was it like working with Carlos for those dance sequences, which are, you know, such a key storytelling component of the film, but also using Carlos to play himself?
Well, at the beginning, we thought Carlos could choreograph those scenes because he has done it before, but we both, Carlos and me, soon saw he wasn't going to have the time. He, at that moment, he was starting with his company, directing it, dancing in it, and he wasn't going to have the time. So we agreed in a choreographer who could do the job, which finally was Maria Rovira. He's a Catalan choreographer who's done the choreographies, most of them in the film. And then actually I was working with her. I went over to Cuba for two long periods to put together the... Paul hinted at what should happen in those dances in the script. And then we took from there into create a choreography. I was there with Maria, because there were scenes of the film, so I needed to be there. And then I bring along the musician, Alberto Iglesias, which is amazing. And once they were created, I saw them in video to Carlos. Carlos approved them. I mean, there was more than anything, he was aware of what we were doing, but he wasn't actually collaborating with him because he was working really, really hard with his company, dancing. But he was always informed and always aware of it. And my feeling is he totally trusted us. He just left it in our hands, and which is amazing. His life in our hands. He was very generous, and we work like that.
Beautiful, beautifully done. This is for both of you, what did you enjoy most about working with this film, if not the dance?
Engaging with Cuba. I mean, it's just a marvellous place, and the people are really brilliant. A very, very particular country, you know, and people forget because of the economic embargo imposed by the United States, which again is totally against international law, has now gone on for 60 years. It's the longest embargo in modern history. But because of that, they've had to be very independent, very, very resourceful. They're a very, very rich culture in, you know, in terms of its traditions. You know, there's a million slaves sent to Cuba, you know, for the sugar industry. So there was great cruelty there. 65% of the present population come from these roots. So they bring tremendous richness and diversity and vitality with them in terms of religion, language, song, culture. So to work with people alongside like that, and also to engage with Cuba, was a great privilege. And there's so much talent there, absolutely brilliant people.
And what can audiences take away from this incredible journey of Carlos's, but that's unique to Carlos's journey, do you think?
I think you can take a lot of it. There is, first of all, the fact that in any other country, would a kid like Carlos, being black and from a poor neighborhood, learn ballet? That's the first thing. I think through the dance in the film, I think we approach people to dance in a different way, because ballet is generally seen as a kind of an elitist art. And I think the film makes it very close. We work very hard in trying to make the dance in the film completely intertwined with the fiction, never lose the audience, never lose the fact that people have gone to see a film, so you cannot suddenly be in the Royal Ballet watching ballet, because that is not the deal. And then also to put the audience in a place where it's very seldom, I mean, it's a place you cannot be, which is on stage. So to actually film ballet is very difficult, because you cannot get too close, you cannot get too distant. So we said, okay, let's be on stage with the dancers, dance with them, have a camera work which actually dances along with them, and put the audience in a place where otherwise it wouldn't be, and get something else, because it's a cinematic experience. And never lose the story, and never lose what we are telling, which is Carlos's life, Carlos's story. So we are seeing the film, we are seeing the story of Carlos Acosta, who's a dancer, and we are seeing dance. And we are seeing a film about Cuba, and about the families there, and about the effort it means to dance at that level. So I think there is a lot to see, hopefully, in the film.
Thank you. Carlos's relationship with his father is central to the story. How did you, and it's sometimes it's tense, complex, and sometimes abusive. How did you balance that and get that across on screen?
Well, it's full of contradiction, as you say. I mean, we forget he was actually a grandson of a slave. He went to work at the age of 9. His whole life, especially before the revolution, was there was great prejudice against the black population. He was beaten up by police if he went into the cinema. You know, so he was a tough cookie. You know, he remembers what it was like. The mafia were there before the revolution, before Castro kicked them all out. So he'd lived all that. So he was no softy. And then when he decided he wanted his son to be a dancer to escape the streets, he says, right, you're going. And he was a brute. He was insensitive, and he was a bully, and he was violent. So what we tried to do is just be truthful and capture all the contradictions of this quite remarkable man.
Thank you so much for your time. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.